Hello. Okay. The next talk is about custom Debian distributions by Andras Thiele. Whenever you want to make a question, just raise your hand, wait for the microphone to reach you, and then you can do the question. And please try to look at the camera, and well, nothing else, Andras.
Yeah. Hello, and I want to add, even if it is announced as a lecture, you can ask in between if you like to do so. But the title is Custom Debian Distributions, and the subtitle is Making Debian the Distribution of Choice for Specific Work Fields. I want to give a little overview of what I want to say, and so I want to give a little overview what's Debian, Custom Debian Distribution. In principle, it is something about linking the upstream developer with the user by just making specific adaptations to Debian. In the second part of the talk, I want to elaborate a little bit on the techniques we are using, and I want to say a little bit about the future of the custom Debian distribution. So I want to give a short introduction, because I think it is third talk I've given at DebCons about custom Debian distributions, but I assure you I will not tell you the same. I'm just going a little bit in the details with the first slide. So, in fact, in Debian we have 22,000 packages, a little bit more, a little bit less, whatever. And in principle, the users are not interested to install all these packages, even if it would be technically possible with the conflicts or whatever. They are normally interested in a subset of packages, and I think you will not find much more than 1,000 packages on a really existing machine. So the problem is every user has a specific work field. So it's not about the fact that every user probably needs a browser and needs an email client. It's about getting specific work done in his day-to-day work. And you normally want these users to get in some easy installation without working down this list of 22,000 packages. What do you think? How long would it take to read 22,000 package descriptions? And I assume you will understand all these package descriptions. It works not for me. I can assure you I will not understand 1,000 of these descriptions, because I just don't understand the concept. So it's about making the user be able to understand what's this really large package pool and what is really useful for me. So, well, Debian is a very general distribution. This is the reason for this is that if you have 1,000 developers, statistically, it is quite ensured that from every working field there is anybody who is working in a specific field. So, in principle, the Debian developers are a good team, or very with enlarging this number of 1,000 people by 3,000 or 4,000 people who are actively providing some stuff, but without being an official Debian developer. I think Martin elaborated on this in this talk. So we have a specialist for every field which is worth working about. So the idea is we do not want to derive from Debian. It is what I also said in the roundtable before. We want to make Debian just in the distribution which is fit for any special purpose, by including final small adaptations to make people able to use special applications, to find these special applications, and to get a computer which is a real workhorse after a short time without doing much work. If you want to bring Debian to the masses, you have to make it brain dead easy to install a computer for a specific purpose. I know that every attendee of this conference is perfectly able to find all the packages which are fine for him. But I want to make it easily accessible for everybody, for your mom or whatever, or your grandma to install a computer which exactly does what she wants it to do. So I had a little funny story. A doctor, a friend of mine, told me, "What are you doing? You are traveling around the world with this stuff. What's this about traveling around the world?" I said, "Well, I'm doing this Linux stuff. You might have heard about Linux." "No, I haven't heard it. It is some kind of secret society." And I admit I was a little bit speechless to call Linux or Debian as a secret society. But I was thinking about it. And it's not that fast, because we know that we are anything else but secret, but we have one feature in the normal life, you know? We are here in this hotel, very close to friends, but if you go out over the street and ask a random passenger, "What's Linux?" He said, "Oh, well, what that?" And if you say, "Well, this is an alternative to this operating system with the Windows," "Oh, I have heard about this. I experienced this 2 times on my travel to here. In the underground in Frankfurt, I was talking to a random passenger, and after telling him that it is something, some alternative to Windows, he asked me, 'Does it have any chance?'" Well, this is really interesting. So I do not want to elaborate on the question whether we have a chance or not. It works for us, and this is okay. But we have one feature. This is a concealment, and I think the concealment is that we, as any other Linux distribution as well, are sometimes concealed under the noise of advertisement of proprietary products. We normally do not advertise what we are doing. Well, we talk to friends that Debian is cool and you could use it, but this is not advertisement. I'm no businessman, and I don't know really how much money compared to the real value is provided by a company is put into advertising, and we are doing just nothing. We have nothing at all. So we are really concealed, which is some way why people think we are a secret society. And we are somehow concealed by the disunity. What do I mean by this? If you talk to people who are a little bit more educated about Linux, and you are asking people, well, since Ubuntu exists a little bit different, but before Ubuntu existed, and you ask people in Germany, "Linux? Ah, SUSE Linux, I know it." And if you ask people in America, "Ah, Red Hat Linux, yes, I know it." If you want to France, Mandrake Linux, yeah, I know it. So there are so many different distributions which are taking over the name Linux. As I said, I have no problem with different distributions. It's fine, and you should use the distribution of your best friend. This is completely fine. But the problem is we are not speaking with one language to the outer part of the world. And this, I think this is not so good. We should try to come closer, because finally we are on the same side. We want to provide free software, and we know the reason for this, and I think we should try to get over this disunity somehow. And one way, this is not the final solution, but I think one way is to breaking the secret by advertising complete solution to these people. So coming back to the friend of mine, which was a doctor, it would be really nice if I could hand over a CD and say, "Well, try the CD and run your practice with it." Well, I think this dream will not be possible before 10 years. And this is 10 years is a large time in computer business, but before it will definitely not be possible. Perhaps it will take longer. And well, in my case with the doctors, is a really special field. Imagine, normally you know your doctor has some money. He doesn't care about you have paying a program or so. But this is different if you come to schools. If you come to schools, we just had a very good example in Extremadura. Every school is running Linux. If you go to Extremadura and ask random people about Linux, they might know, because every school is running it. And so they are providing a complete solution. The solution is putting Linux on every single box in the school, and this means in every classroom is one computer for two pupils. So not only in the computer cabinet or whatever. I've seen the Extremadura. I called Germany a developing country after I've seen the schools there, because if I go into the school of my son, there is a one computer cabinet with 20, 25 computers, and it is used once a week by the pupil. That's not very funny, and I do not want to tell you what hardware and what software anyway is running on these computers. So, I mean, if we try to break the secret by providing ready solution for schools, for some enterprises, for very specific work fields, people might know Linux and might know free software and might know Debian if we manage to do it. So, next point is you will want to be some missing links between upstream developer and the users. What do I mean with this? I learned that several upstream developers do some work, to get some tasks done for their day-to-day life. And well, if some Debian developer is able to detect the software, he can make a package, and finally the user, if he is lucky, finds the program in the 22,000 packages. The problem is sometimes that these, I call the upstream developers experts to solving a certain task, have a lot of knowledge about the task they are doing, but they are have quite frequently not enough knowledge to have a solid build system, write proper make files, use auto make stuff, and so this is some knowledge many upstream developers do not really care. And so the upstream developers anticipates the enhancement of Debian developer if he said, well, you are building a library with some compile option. What about using libtool or something like that? So the Debian developer has a completely different view on the building of the package and how to integrate some software into a complete system. And so the work of the Debian developers is greatly appreciated normally by the upstream developer, because it enhances the quality of his software and also helps to propagate it to other distributions. So we as a Debian developer give some value back to upstream. And finally, it is, in my opinion, a good idea to get this upstream developer closer to Debian by telling them, well, what would you like to think about becoming a Debian developer, because, well, you are doing some good stuff and you are the best man to verify that your software really works and you know all options and so. So I think it's a good idea to get these upstream developers in. And the same is true if you want to become interesting for your users. You provide some ready packages from upstream over Debian to the user. And then I have some very interesting guys working with medical software who are really, really happy that we are doing this stuff in Debian. So, but why should these upstream developers not work with some other distributions? Well, the first problem is the main distributors, with the main commercial distributors like Red Hat and SUSE, care for, well, finally, the shareholder value and do not really care for this special application. This is fine. If it's for kind of a special application from upstream, it makes a lot of work for a distributor to find, for instance, a special school management system or so, to move to its distribution, test it, roll it out to the users, and you cannot make so much money from the schools because normally they have not so money, at least is this my experience in Germany. And so it is questionable if SUSE would roll out a school distribution. And so the chances to do it in Debian are higher because we do not have to care about making money. We can say, well, it makes perfectly sense to do this, and we try to do it. And as I told you before in the roundtable, it is a kind of duocracy principle. We think it is reasonable to do this and that, and we just do it, and then it works. And that's why we have a good chances to be the missing link between the upstream developers and the end users. Another point I want to make is I try to make it in Martin Maddox's talk with a method diversion. If you want to attract your users, you have to, you can talk to him that you are very good or what this is advertising, but as I said, advertising doesn't really work for us. We have to just provide interesting techniques that the user wants to use our stuff. So the acceptance of the new methods we want to provide to our users has to be based on a solid technical base. So to say, well, we have this and this feature, and people really want to use it. If they do not want to use it, they will find something else by chance. But it must be attractive by providing good by good techniques. So what we found out in the custom Debian distribution effort is we try to provide good ways to make packages into categories. Categories means this is a work field. For this work field, you need package A, B, C, D, and we put it in one category, or we call it task files. I think the main point once people joined this custom Debian distribution effort was that we started providing web pages which are just making these task files visible. Up to 1 year ago, Debian Med was the only custom distribution which was using a technique which was intended to work for all of them. Then I was able to convince the Debian Edu people, and we found a common framework. And this framework was just displaying, I will show you in the second part, what we are doing. And this pushed the number of CDDs which are using this technique by to 5, and probably 3 or 4 others are in the queue to take over this technique. We have found some kind of key documentation feature, and documentation is, in principle, our only way to advertise to the users. We have good documentation. You can read it. You can see what we are doing. And so we have some means to promote software that builds a really complete working environment. You can browse down a list, which is not a package pool of 22,000 packages, but 20 packages, which are really specific to your work field. And so we can finally raise the end user interest to install this software of their work field, and we also provide means to do it with one mouse click or one apt-get line or whatever. So because upstream developers are often weak in just advertising their software, they just put their software on the web page and are done. And in the better one are using Savanna or SourceForge, but it's not, I have seen software which was provided this way. I like sailing and some pictures about sailing. I like cats. This is my cat's pictures. And on the very bottom of the webpage was a link to medical practice management software. Well, this doesn't work. Nobody will find it. And so you have to care about better ways of distributing the software. So Debian wants to help these people and provide a much more simpler access and to make sure that this software is not just hidden like a needle in the haystack. And CDDs are somehow, well, I call it a kind of a looking glass into the Debian package pool. If you are looking at the Debian package pool, this is probably the user who just have read 22,000 package descriptions, which are swirling around his head, and he is absolutely not able to make any sense of it. Just use some logos from packages and some GIMP magic. And now comes Debian Edu and makes this. And you are focusing the interest of the user exactly on the Debian Edu stuff. And people notice, oh, there is something which makes me happy. Or Debian Metas, this is our stuff. Forget the other stuff. We care about your database system or Apache stuff. This is not for you. You don't have to care about it. Just try to use the applications and do not try to install all this stuff which needs computer expert experience and knowledge. Just click on one button, install this, and you are fine. So this is in principle is what we are doing in CDDs, and everything of this whole slide is inside Debian. This is an important point. And the term custom Debian distribution is I admit this is really broken because it says for somebody who hears the term custom Debian distribution is immediately clear it is something else than Debian. And when I was having talks about custom Debian distribution, Debian Science or so, I told them, we are doing everything completely inside Debian. I told them once, twice, or three times in the talk. And the first question after my talk was, why are you doing some additional distribution about scientific software? Couldn't you use Debian? I said, well, yes, I told you, but you was not hearing. And I'm thinking about finding a different name. There's even a wiki page renaming custom Debian distribution to something else, which makes more sense to make people understand immediately. If you hear a name, you should know what it means, or you could name it like a fancy thing. But a name which implicitly say something else, and it's a little bit broken. It was not my idea, sorry. So now I'm coming to the technical part of the talk and how to use this CDD dev package. Well, basically, it is doing some very simple Debian control files. You have to give a task name. The task is, for instance, in school, mathematics, physics. So that's just the topics which are run in school or whatever. Or we have Debian Junior. They have games, writing, also what is fit, which makes, in Debian Junior case, makes the small children able to write something. It contains some simple text processing program or something like this, or games. The task is just the topic of the thing you can do with your computer. Then this task has a short description, long description. You know this is what's always inside the Debian control file. And then we have some depends. So this task depends from package A, B, C. And you can have recommends, or so you recommend other packages. And you can have suggested packages. So this is quite simple. The CDD dev tool now parses this task file to make sure that the package you mention as depends and recommends are really available in the Debian package pool. It might happen that the package vanishes from Debian because it's RC buggy or whatever and just goes out. And so the CDD dev tool just verifies that you get a really working control file. Then we have done one thing that if you specify depends in your task file. We turn it into recommends, and this the idea was you should be able to deinstall the meta package because, well, some people do not want to have this resulting meta package, and recommends are installed by default anyway, and so we are discussing about this, but in principle you should not wonder about, well, depends end up in recommends. This is made some sense. The packages which are not available in main will be turned into suggests. That means if you have non-free packages mentioned as recommends or depends, you do not have to check that. The CDD dev tool just realizes this is not in main, so we just suggest it. It is perfectly able to install the meta package, and the suggests are just ignored, or you can install them using, if you are using Synaptic or so, just click on install suggests, and so it is just to make sure that the resulting meta package can in any case be included in Debian main. This is the main idea why we turn the not existing packages in suggests. And you can even mention packages that are not even included in Debian itself. I will come back to this later if I will talk about the prospective packages part. So CDD dev tries to create a proper Debian control file to build these meta packages. And in addition to this, task-cell control file is generated. This is heavily used by the Debian edu people, which are using some installer who is just presenting the user with the Debian edu task-cell file. Because if a user is installing Debian, he gets a do you want a desktop and then a mail server or whatever. It makes no sense for a specific use. The specific user knows that he wants to want a machine which should be running in the computer lab in the school or in a medical practice, and he wants to have the specific task solved. So this task-cell file is also generated by CDD dev. So then we have some web tools to make sure that the information in the meta packages is easily accessible for people who are not just installing, just want to have a look at it. And Debian Med has developed several web tools which are taken over to the other custom Debian distribution as well. For instance, there is a so-called bugs overview. There is a link to the Debian Description Translation project. These people are just having a small meeting in the micro scene. They could tell you more about this. Then we are doing some QA features, which means I do not think that a custom distribution, Debian distribution, is only about packaging software. I think we should form a team which really cares about this software. We have no image. So, but I think it will show up later, and I can keep on talking. Is this okay? Yeah. That's okay. So we are making some QA stuff in the custom Debian distribution feature, because building a distribution is not only building packages, but it is just caring for your users. And if the user has broken packages, or if the quality of the package is not as we expect, the user becomes frustrated. And so we try to build really good teams who are watch the QA status, and we are using the really nice QA features which are were presented yesterday by Tincho. Tincho also had this Debian Med view, and I was happy that he liked it. And finally, we have this task overview. And I managed to make this task overview available for all other Debian distributions, and it's now a little bit a shame that I cannot really continue without the screen because I wanted to present something. It's my laptop at least provided with in the stream. What should I do? So it is streamed what I'm saying. So if people have it in their screen, I just continue. So we have this bugs overview for custom daemon distribution. Yeah, it's working. It's coming in. So this is great. Thank you for the technique people. And I've just reinitialized. Oh yes, great. Thank you. So this bug overview just looks at the task files I mentioned, looks for the dependencies, and looks for the bugs. All these dependent packages are showing. And I'm sorry, I just used a German locale just to make sure you see that it's localized, this bug overview. It's not to because I forgot it. We have this localized page, and you are looking at Debian Med bug overview. So the Esculap is a viewer for medical images, and this is one bug and whatever. And this bug overview is has a color scheme scheme which makes sure that the release critical bugs are colored red, the yellow and greenish ones are not so important bugs, and the blue are wishlist bugs. You see, it is a translation bug in the Esculap stuff, and so I can show you online later on if you want. Then for the Debian description translation project, if we say we care for our users, it doesn't mean we care for our English-speaking users. It means we care for all users, and especially if you come to real end users in a clinic, for instance, I think if you go here in a hospital in Mar del Plata and would like to find anybody of the staff who's able to understand a single description in English of our packages, well, you get some money from me. I don't care how money. I don't think you find anybody. So we try to care about the translation of all this stuff. And so, well, you see yourself some descriptions, some countries. We have this overview only for some languages. In principle, we could add more, but it makes no sense to make a list with only red crosses. We try to find out the languages which are quite good translated. So here the Brazilian do very well, the Spanish and the German are also well. The Japanese, I wonder why the Japanese have so many red crosses, because they are normally are very well translated. Probably it is the special field which is not so good translated. And the Italian guys have some work to do. So this is the overview of the Debian description translation project, and you could click on this special packages if you want to translate. You have an easy way, or you should have. We are working on this on DebConf. This is a few you can see. This is another example from the Debian Med project, and you see that these three translations are translated. Three transcriptions are translated, and the Italian one is the missing one. And you find a link if you can speak Italian language and want to provide some translations. You can do it. So this is what I understand with doing custom daemon distribution stuff. Not only building packages. Care for your users. Make sure they understand what you are doing. So then we are watching upstream. This is a part of this QA stuff. You find it in the qa.packages.debian.org stuff. We just put a different layout on it, and we cared for showing up all the packages we care. It's also an example from Debian made, because it is not yet ported for the other CDDs. I'm just working on it. And so you see for which of the packages we care about are new upstream versions available. So you have a very easy overview over this set of packages you are really interested in. And you can also see which other features of the QA work is interesting for your very specific package set. So finally, we have so-called prospective packages. This is, in short, this is our to-do list. That means the following. If there is a WNPP bug, ITP something, which is interesting for us, we just use the package file as a main source of information and just put these items into the task file. So depends of the not yet existing package homepage, responsible. It is interesting to know who actually issued this ITP bug, but because, well, sometimes this person just vanished, and so you can ask, are you interested? So then the license, the number of the bug, and if there is an unofficial package, you can put the URL here, because the user might be interested to install the unofficial package. Perhaps there is an external repository not yet included in Debian, and this is doing the trick. This depends, goes in the list of suggested packages. And if the user in this on his machine just adds an additional source line, he just can install this unofficial package. So this is an additional feature, and then you give the package description. The effect of putting this, I think this is not so good scaled, I just use Debian Science stuff, because, can you see this better? This pages are ported to all the CDDs, and it's very easy to, you just need to create task files. And if you go to the astronomy task, you get the green ones are the packages we have in Debian. So, and if I browse down, we have a lot of astronomy related packages. Was you aware of this? Who was aware of this? Yeah. So this is a problem. You have to get an easy overview about what's really in Debian with the special working field. And now we come to the yellow section. These are experimental or unofficial Debian packages. That means there are any Debian packages out there, or there is some packaging stuff in a repository or whatever. And these one are listed here. I don't know if the projector makes it really good yellowish. Green is above, and the below is yellow, I said. And the red ones, this is a real to-do list. We have a WNPP bug, but it is not so, there is no official package available, and there is some work to do. And this is just listed to make the users aware. So if you see it on your screen, this is red. This is better on the web page, so sorry. If the user sees the green ones, packages are in Debian, well, it's fine, I can use them. The yellow ones, I have good chances to install on my machine, and these people are really working. They are working on this stuff, and they are showing what work is done, and it also makes sure for the CDD people that they do not forget. I do not know if there are more ITP bugs which are solved by an upload of a package, or which are solved by just removing it from VNPP because nobody cares anymore. And so this list makes sure that the package will not be forgotten. So this is our tasks pages, And these task pages finally convinced several people to take over this technique. It was the Debian Junior people had some issues why we do not want these task files built this way and that way, and why should we use it. And now they are using it as well. So here are this is what I showed you online. So coming to the end, my plan is, well, it was on my to list for DevConf, but I doubt that I will finally do it. I want to do some further enhancement to these task pages to make it some more. For my it's my last slide. Time's running out. It's the last slide. Thank you. I've got some additional minutes. So it's the last slide anyway. So I want to do some further enhancements to this task page. I also want to port all this fine web stuff, which was done by one of our Debian Mate crew, namely David Palaino, for available for other CDDs. It is just some factorization, putting some variables where Debian Mate was formerly, and changing some URLs. So this is probably quite cheap to make available for all CDDs. And I also try to bring back external projects to the Debian community by providing these tools. So we have several people, and we've seen them in the roundtable, for instance, the Munich people. If they think, well, this is a cool tool to show our administration that if we join closely to Debian, we have some benefit, then perhaps it makes life easier to join Debian, to make the focus that your special task is really interesting for us, and we want to care for it. And so I really hope that we will have success to people who derive from Debian but might come back. And well, if you wonder whether you find these slides, you will find them after my talk. I just didn't link to this, but normally you find all my talks and this URL, and so it's also the old talks, and it's, you can feel free to ask some questions. No questions? It either means you didn't understood me, or I explained everything so good that you perfectly understand. Oh.
Perhaps just a comment. One thing that I've started to see is a lot more people are producing bug overviews for different things and mm-hmm. duplicating a lot of work that should really be done in mm-hmm. a centralized location. Yeah. One thing that would be nice is, instead of people making more bug mm-hmm. overviews, mm-hmm. if they started working with me and the yeah. rest of the DevBugs team to make those overviews available, because there's nothing mm-hmm. Inherent in the architecture of DevBugs mm-hmm. that makes those types of overviews impossible to do. That's something that would, mm-hmm. instead of duplicating work, would be better spent doing it at once centralized.
Yes, there's a very good hint, and I wanted to come back to you once I'm there. This David Palaino is a very great guy. He was very fast doing things, and I hope in the process when I want to generalize this, that we find a solution which duplicates at less as possible. So we just want to have this specific view and this specific package, and if there is a solution which makes this brain dead easy, then I will talk to you.
Just to make it really obvious, you can do it now. It'll be a long URL, but you can list every single package that you're mm-hmm. interested in a single query, mm-hmm. and it'll show you only those bugs that are mm-hmm. in those packages. So, yeah. In a single tiny .ul, whatever yeah, the URL yeah. thing is, you would have that exact yeah, review page
is,
that you have.
This is great, yeah. Yeah, so we definitely want to avoid making more and more stuff. This is just to get this set is our interest and provide all the bugs, and if it's easy to use with the BTS, I'm very happy about this. Some more questions? So there's no point in waiting any longer, and I got the red light from there. Oh yeah, Thiago.
Andres, It's documented in your article that if you obtain the complete Debian GNU Linux distribution, you have all available custom Debian distribution included. Is that works for the install process? Like, I don't know if it's possible to have a Debian install, a custom Debian installer for a CDD. If I don't know if you consider that should be the same Debian installer inside Debian, or if I change something, the installer, like the images banner or some splash in Syslinux or.
Yeah. Okay. You are scratching on the definition issue of the custom Debian distribution. In principle, in my opinion, it should be possible if you are creating your CDD installer. You set just a switch to the build process, and this build process cares for just turning one single switch to install Debian Edu or Debian Brazilian. To make sure that is an installation medium must install this CDD. This should be the ideal ideal goal. We could probably could make some tweaks or whatever. But and I do not know if it is really possible to reach this final goal. But this is. The goal is to change as less as possible in Debian, and if you think it's not possible for you to make this installer this way, then make the installer is tiny bit different with a different image or whatever. But you could even put your splash image in a package in Debian which is needed to build your installer. At least this is my idea. If you disagree, just tell me.
No, I agree. It's just a question.
Anybody else? So thank you very much for your attention.